So yeah, I believe that the problem of public goods is an overrated problem. This is not going to be a long video and a very detailed exploration of the subject, but I have a couple of points to share with you, and I hope you find them interesting. I do find them interesting. So yeah, this is from the conversation with my brother-in-law that I had this afternoon. Again, he's a libertarian. He's sort of getting educated slowly in economics and philosophy and whatnot. And he's talking to somebody at work who is sort of curious about libertarianism, but keeps posing questions that he believes are difficult or impossible for libertarians to overcome or to have an adequate response to. And my brother-in-law is sort of struggling with giving him cohesive, exhaustive arguments. So public goods, to remind you what the public good is, in economics, in economic theory, a public good is something that possesses two characteristics. The characteristics are a non-rivalrousness and non-exclusivity. When a good is non-rivalrous, what it means is that one person consuming this good does not preclude other persons from consuming the same good. For example, if you take like a ham sandwich is an excludable good. If I eat it, you can't be eating it at the same time. Well, you can imagine a scenario where people are eating like a sub sandwich from two ends simultaneously, but I'm talking about, let's say like a chocolate candy, you put it in your mouth, you eat it, it's gone. For another person to consume that good, you must have not consumed it. But other things like, fireworks, right? Fireworks is a good, perhaps, we could say, a consumer good. Well, you're watching the fireworks. The fireworks is being displayed. You watching it doesn't preclude other people from watching it at the same time. So it's not... am I talking about rivalrousness? Yes. It's not rivalrous in that sense that... some person consuming a good does not mean that another person cannot be consuming the same good at the same time. So, and the excludability means being able to exclude the non-payer, right? So, again, if I buy a ham sandwich, then I possess the sandwich and everything's hunky-dory. If I'm not willing to pay for the sandwich, the owner of the sandwich, let's say a sandwich shop, can very easily preclude me, stop me from consuming that good. They will simply not give it to me, right? And when I pay, they give it over to me, and again, everybody's happy. I now own the good, they have my money. Well, what would be the examples of public goods? I want to explore some of the examples of public goods, show you perhaps that it's not as clear-cut as mainstream economic theory would have you believe. And I'm going to look at all those characteristics, the non-rivalrousness and the non-exclusivity, and to see how they play out in real life and what it means for real life. And I'm also going to explore the premise that is being used as a justification for government interference in certain areas of the economy, meaning the premise being if we establish this, X is a public good, that means that the government needs to provide it. So the theory actually says that the government, the public goods, because they're non-rivalrous and you can't exclude the non-payer, that means they're being underproduced or not produced at all. Because simply there is no incentive to produce it in adequate amounts. The producers, if they cannot exclude the non-payers, for example, then that means that there's going to be a free rider problem. People are going to be consuming the good that have not contributed to its creation by paying for it, and therefore the producers are going to have less of an incentive or no incentive at all to produce that said good. Kind of makes sense on the surface, right? But the argument used in politics goes actually further than that. It says, well, since a public good is being underproduced or not produced at all by the free market, the government needs to either induce more production of that said good or simply take over its production. If it's not being produced, then the government should just go ahead and produce it because people need it, but because of the problem of public good, they're not getting it. So there you go. Well, okay, let's look at the characteristic of non-excludability, right? What are the examples of non-excludable goods? Well, let's say a public space in the street, right? People are walking in the street. A lot of people are walking in the street. How are you going to exclude the non-payer? Like, the only way to have a street, the theory goes, is to have government own it and, you know, clean it and repair the asphalt on it and whatnot, pavement and so forth. Because if you don't do that, if the street's just private, well, are they going to set up like tolls and sell tickets to enter the street? Oh no, that would be horrible. Or no, they wouldn't do it, and therefore there would be non-payers. So the maintenance, the construction and maintenance of that street is not going to get adequate resources, and therefore the street is either not going to be built and maintained at all, or something else terrible will happen. Therefore, the government needs to own the streets. Or, say, the lighthouse, right? You can't exclude people from looking at the lighthouse. The lighthouse serves as a valuable waypoint for ships. It shows ships where they should be cautious, you know, avoid, you know, being broken against the rocks and something, or something. And you know, but once the lighthouse is shining its light, then everybody can see it. People have paid for it, and people have not paid for it. Therefore, there's going to be an underproduction of lighthouses. Therefore, you know, it's only logical that the lighthouses should be run collectively by the government. Well, okay, well, let's look at how non-excludable those goods really are, like the street. Why would we believe that the street is non-excludable? I mean, you know, certain large malls, for example, essentially are streets covered over by like a glass roof or something. So those spaces could easily be made excludable. There are private gated communities that are clearly excludable. Another example of public good, like let's say you're showing a movie, the movie is playing, right? Another person entering into the movie theater and sitting down to watch the movie does not detract, does not complicate a picture in any way. The movie is already being played. The light waves are hitting that space where nobody's sitting right now. Well, if somebody sits there and their eyeballs become the recipients of those light waves and their eardrums become the recipients of the sound waves, as in they begin to consume the movie, or am I talking about non-rivals just now? Yeah, I'm sorry. This is an incohesive rant, so bear with me. So we'll deal with the movie later. But you can't exclude a non-payer in the movie theater, obviously. So what was I talking about? I'm sorry. I know I'm confusing. Anyway, I think the non-excludability, the non-excludability is actually kind of questionable. You can, in a lot of cases, exclude the non-payers. You know, in the case of a public space or a space, street, a shopping mall, you can clearly do that. Like Walt Disney, once you enter the park, one of the parks are huge, and you're enjoying yourself just walking down those private streets, patronizing the stores and stuff. Obviously, they're charging you the price of admission. They're selling you tickets. Well, they're excluding people from an entire town, right? If you don't want to go there, you don't go there, right? But if you do want to go there, do want to do the rides and the stores and just walk around and look at those buildings, and some of them are pretty spectacular, what they've done there. I took my family there last fall, and I enjoyed it in spite of myself. I was not expecting to enjoy it as much as I did. I think they've done a fabulous, tremendous job. Anyway, so you're obviously able to exclude people there. I don't see this as such a big problem. The problem really is about incentives. Like, if you can't exclude the non-payers, therefore you don't have the incentive to produce the good. Well, not necessarily. Maybe there's enough payers to justify your investment in producing that good. And maybe, and this is where it gets really interesting and sort of really connected with reality and the, you know, how people have coped with this in real life. If you can bundle it, with other goods that are clearly excludable, then the non-excludability kind of goes away, right? But I'll talk about that in a minute. So non-rivalrousness then. Me consuming a good does not stop you from consuming a good. Therefore, I don't have an incentive to pay. If you've already paid and the good has been produced, I can just consume it and not pay. Well, okay. Again, on the surface, kind of makes sense. But, like a movie theater, right? It's non-rivalrous from the standpoint of another customer walking into the theater where the movie is already playing. Well, it's already being played. And if there's a seat and I can sit down, I'm not detracting from anybody, so why would anybody pay? Well, obviously, in the movie theater, they have clerks and, you know, ushers and people checking your tickets at the entrance and stuff. But the thing is, the movie theater is not infinite. The space in the movie theater is not infinite. Neither is the street, by the way. Like, okay, you can have maybe 100 people walking down the same street, but not a million people. A million people is not going to fit there, right? So it's rivalrous in that sense. Also, theoretically and practically too, like how many ships can see the lighthouse at the same time? They will be, you know, you can't imagine 1,000 ships seeing that lighthouse because they would have to be packing that chunk of the ocean pretty closely. So there's a limit to the non-rivalrousness because of physical limitations of space, right? You know, you can only fit so many people in a given space, be it a street or a movie theater, or, you know, an area in the sea where that is being serviced by the lighthouse. But I want to, I know, I mean, this is a horrible video. I'm not making too much sense. I know I'm making sense, but these points are sort of not really connected. I didn't rehearse this, so. Let's look at some of the examples that are used by academic economists to justify their position on public goods. And I'm going to challenge those with some historical examples of how public goods were actually provided privately very successfully, and therefore they're not really public goods then, at least it seems that way to me. And the most famous example is obviously the lighthouse, and I'm going to link in the description to a paper, an article on that. In fact, the historical fact, very shortly, very briefly, is there have been plenty of private lighthouses, okay? And the way that the public good, quote-unquote, problem was solved was, I can see two ways, really. One, people bundled this seemingly public good with a private good. For example, harbors would charge ships for services, like you would have the pilot, and you would have, you know, like, berths and, is that the word? Anyway, ships would have to be unloaded. There's a whole lot of services going on in the harbor when the ship, you know, comes in to unload the cargo or take on a cargo. So people who owned the harbors and managed the harbors and built the lighthouse would simply bundle the lighthouse with the harbor. So you pay your harbor fee, and into that fee is baked the fee for the lighthouse. Voila. You solve the problem. The lighthouse, its construction and maintenance is being paid for by the users. Now, obviously, there's going to be non-payers that are going to be using the lighthouse. So freaking what? Okay? The point is, the lighthouse exists. It is able to be maintained. It's operational. People are using it. Everybody's happy. I don't see what the problem is. And again, there's been plenty of private lighthouses for a very, very, very long time. In Britain, and also in America. I was listening to a lecture by Tom DeLorenzo recently, and he was talking about a lighthouse somewhere in Delaware, south of here, on the East Coast, where another way, by the way, this is an illustration of another method, or other like approach to solving the seeming public goods problem with the lighthouse. A bunch of merchants whose ships would regularly be wrecked against some rocks off of the Delaware coast pulled their resources and built a freaking lighthouse. Okay, it was useful or valuable to them enough to justify that expense. They greatly reduced the risk of losing their cargo and losing their ship, and they were happy to just band together and do it as a group. And who cares if other people see it? See, that's the problem with so-called public goods. The assumption is, oh, because there's a difficulty with the incentive structure, the good is not going to be produced at all. Like these merchants were supposed to, according to the most common view of the public good problem, those merchants were supposed to think, oh well, you know, we're not going to build a lighthouse because obviously, you know, there's going to be non-payers and we can't exclude them. So, you know, it's non-rivalrous. So, you know, shit. I guess we just have to keep losing our ships and losing our cargoes. Well, no, that's not what they decided. They decided to do it anyway. And who cares if there's some non-payers who are using it? It's okay. At least, apparently, that's what they thought. So the good did get produced. It did deliver valuable services to those who produced it. And everybody's happy, okay? So two things. You can try and bundle it with a private good, or you can just go ahead and bear the expense and produce the good anyway and just live with the fact that there's going to be some non-payers using it as well. But as long as you're being helped by that good, you're getting the value from your investment into its production or into its purchase, then you're fine. So, I think that's a very, very interesting illustration of how overblown this so-called problem really is. The other thing that I want to challenge is the assumption that just because a good might be public or... I want to challenge the whole definition of public good as well. They're going to say it's going to be underproduced. Well, according to what? Underproduced. Not enough of it is going to be produced. Well, who's to say what's enough? Okay? Where does this idea of, oh, this much of this good is not enough, but that much would be enough? By what standard is that determination made? How are you coming up with these things? We need more of it. Well, who's we? How do you decide that you need more of it? Okay. When people decide that they need more of something, they go ahead and purchase it or make it or produce it, whatever. As did those merchants in Delaware. So this not enough, underproduction according to what? According to some ideal concept that some economist has? Why are we supposed to take that as a valid definition of how much of a good is supposed to exist or be produced? I don't get it. I don't get it. I was watching a video by Lengthian Arthur earlier today about defense, and that's another thing that is typically cited as generally a public good. And he made the same point that I referred to earlier about this nonsensical concept that, oh, because there's a difficult incentive structure, people are just going to go ahead and not produce the good at all. Well, if they need it, they're going to produce it. Okay, like defense. Well, he made an excellent example, I thought, with food. Let's say food was a public good. Somehow food was not capable of being produced individually, only as a group. But once you produce it, it's a hypothetical, obviously, that let's say that once you produce it, non-payers could consume it as well. Does it mean that everybody would just give up and starve and not produce any food at all? I don't think so. I don't think so. Same goes for defense. Just because there's going to be some non-payers benefiting from other people investing in defense doesn't mean that those people are going to decide not to defend themselves, right? This is frustrating. This, by the way, is a very fine cigar. I mean, it's not very expensive. It's called Man o' War Ruination. Very good. It's not expensive. Not too expensive. But I love the taste. It's generally great. And the final assumption that I want to challenge is just because some good might be a public good or we suspect it might be a public good, the assumption is that somehow government must produce it. Well, says who? Says who? What's the government got to do with it? How does that come in? It's an assumption that's being sneaked in by the supposedly value-free economists. Where do they get that conclusion? How do they come to that conclusion? I have no idea. especially in light of the fact that governments are notoriously bad at producing pretty much anything. They're hugely inefficient. The government incentives are actually very, very perverse as well. Not as well, they're more perverse than the incentives in the case of alleged public good. The government, since the government doesn't get paid as normal market actors do by winning the loyalty of customers, by convincing the customers that their good or service is valuable and convincing them to voluntarily give over, hand over their money in exchange for that good or service, the government's incentives are always, if they're a monopolist of providing a certain service, let's say roads or police protection. Police protection is sort of an oxymoron, but police, right? Hans Hermann Hoppe correctly points out that if you're a monopolist, if you're a monopolist that has outlawed people from competing with oneself, with yourself, say in providing police, right? And if you're going to get funding anyway because you're taxing people, you're not selling your services in a free open market where people have to actually decide to buy your service. If you're in that situation, you have every incentive to produce less and less of a service or a good. A service or a good. Not a good way to put it. You have less and less of an incentive over time to produce that, that good in sufficient quantities and qualities, and that sufficient quality, and more incentive to just keep raising the price. Therefore, the government keeps getting more and more expensive to the taxpayer, and the government services tend, their quality and quantity tend to go down. Yeah, if I wasn't a monopolist, I would be under the same incentives. I would be incentivized to care less and less about the quality and quantity of a service or a product that I produce, and just keep collecting the money. In fact, collecting more and more money because there's no alternative. People cannot not pay, and they cannot go to anybody else for the same service. So why should I bother? Okay. So introducing government to this equation hardly solves any public good problem, if that problem even exists. Again, please recognize this fact. The government has no economic incentive to provide good roads. Okay? They've monopolized the roads, pretty much, but they're going to get funded anyway. They can just tax you. They can just send you a bill from the IRS and say, you owe us money. And what are you going to do? Not pay? I wonder how that's going to work out for you if you have the guts to try it. I wouldn't. I honestly say I would not have the guts to openly resist tax collectors because I know what they're going to do to you if you do. If you Google like taxes, New Hampshire couple, tax evasion or tax resisters or something, you'll find a story. I forget their names right now. There's a couple that are incarcerated right now. Say incarcerated? Yeah, that's not a word. Would be, it wouldn't be a very good word if it was a word. So they're incarcerated. In fact, they're incarcerated separately. They're in their 60s or 70s. They decided to make a stand. They believed that they were being taxed unconstitutionally. And I'm not gonna go, I'm not gonna give you my position on the validity of that argument. Basically, I think all taxation is illegitimate because it's theft. It's the taking of property of others by use of force and threat of force and threat of violence. They were used violence against people. The police and SWAT besieged their house and arrested their friends. One friend of theirs who was walking their dog was shot at by SWAT members who were ambushed him in the woods nearby their house, and they're now in jail. So that's what's going to happen to you. If you don't believe that that's going to happen to you, you're terribly naive or a moron. They will put you in jail, and they will take your stuff anyway, with guns. Why? Because they can. Okay? They can. So yeah, like you can't stop paying for the government service for the roads. They will keep taxing you. Are you happy with the quality of the roads that you get? I mean, obviously everything's relative. A lot of people complain about the roads in Russia, and mostly roads in Russia are horrific. Over here, by contrast, they're actually not too bad. In Germany, they're pretty darn exceptional. But that doesn't prove it. The German roads doesn't don't prove anything. I don't know why. Maybe Germans don't just, hate bad roads as a general principle. And Americans don't. American government agencies that are responsible for building roads don't have any problem with building and maintaining crappy roads. I don't know. I don't know. But just the quality of the road is one thing. The cost of the road is another thing. Like, how do you know that the government is building the roads efficiently and maintaining them efficiently? Even if you were completely happy with the quality of the road, how do you know that you're getting a good deal? In absence of a market, you don't know whether you're getting a good deal. There's no competition. All right? There's no market check. If competition was allowed, if people were allowed to build completely private roads and compete with government roads, then we would find out. I guess we could find out whether we're getting a good deal from government on the roads. Right? So the lighthouse story is actually pretty interesting. People had been using the example of lighthouses as a, totally convincing to them example of a public good until somebody, I think it was Ronald Coase, actually went ahead and did some research on it and found out that no, in fact, lots and lots and lots of lighthouses were privately built and operated for a very long time. So that kind of broke down. But still, you'll hear people make those examples. You'll hear economists make those examples. I guess they're not aware of the research, or maybe they're aware, but they're just in denial, which is very convenient and very common. And roads, there's whole literature on privatization of roads, and even in our completely statist road economy, there are examples of private roads that are doing beautifully. Okay, if you're interested in exploring this topic further, I would recommend just going to Wikipedia and looking for free market roads. I would recommend going to like iTunes University and looking for audio lectures by Walter Block, who's written a book, Privatization of Roads and Highways. So there's a whole literature about how it's absolutely plausible that private roads could exist, easily exist, with completely no interference or subsidy from the government. Also, historically, there's been plenty of private roads in Britain, in America. Lots and lots of road construction was going on, and people were figuring out ways to actually make them excludable, those goods, right? For example, I forget where I heard this story from, but in the early 19th century, late 18th century, late 18th and early 19th century, there's plenty of roads being built very actively in the United States, privately, completely privately financed. And the road operators collected tolls, and they would look at the cart and look at the wheels, and if the wheel was wide, they would charge a lower toll as opposed to a narrower wheel, because narrower wheel did more damage to the road, obviously because of the pressure. Your contact area is greater with a wider wheel, and therefore damage to the road. The groove that you leave in the road is shallower, if it exists at all. So narrow road, no, narrow wheel carts were charged higher toll. Brilliant, brilliant. There's no way you can just say, "Oh no, that won't ever work." It has worked. It is working right now in limited areas, and it would absolutely work. It's completely plausible. Also, another thing, like I was speaking to a neighbor and a friend, we were talking about railroads, and I was like, well, who's going to build the railroads if not the government? I said, well, who's going to build the railroads? The people who build railroads. Like, have you heard of James J. Hill? And she's like, well, who's he? Well, James J. Hill is obviously the guy who built the Great Northern, the most successful transcontinental railroad in America. He was competing against two other transcontinental roads that were completely subsidized up and down, right, left, and center, completely subsidized by the government via a direct monetary subsidy, via land grants. Like they would grant, the government would just seize land, declare the land federal property, and just grant the land to the federally subsidized, corrupt, crony railroad company, and they would give them like 100 miles, a width of 100 miles along the track, and railroads would just sell those lands. They got them at a zero cost. They would sell them at huge profits, obviously. But even all of that, those railroads went bankrupt, but the Great Northern was very, very profitable. And James J. Hill has taken, it took $0 and 0 cents in subsidies from the federal government, and he received not a single square foot of land grants. He bought all that land. He bought right of way. He negotiated with Indian tribes. He didn't exterminate them, like the army of the North after the so-called Civil War, which is really not a civil war, and that's a topic of a whole another lecture or video, whatever. Civil wars are when competing factions fight for the control of the government. The so-called civil war in the United States was not two factions fighting over control of the government. It was one faction trying to leave and the other forcibly preventing it from leaving. So it was more like a war to prevent southern independence would be a more accurate term. So after that war, there was this huge northern army that they didn't know what to do with, and they deployed that army to fight the Indians. In fact, to exterminate the Indians. And the good Indian is a dead Indian. Comes from that time. Well, James J. Hill didn't do any of that, and he was very meticulous about cost management, and he was very ingenious in how he built those roads. He built them with superb quality, unlike the subsidized railroads, which built very shoddy foundations for the roads and the beds and whatever the term is, and they would build them so shoddily that they would build them on top of the snow, packed snow in early spring, and then when the snow would melt, the track would disintegrate, and they would have to build all over again. But they were subsidized per mile, and therefore their roads were like this. Instead of being straight and as short as possible, they were actually incentivized to build them inefficiently. And they still went bankrupt, and James J. Hill didn't. Okay, that's an example of a seemingly public good being successfully produced privately, in fact, alongside a subsidized railroads and outcompeting those subsidized. I think it's a tremendous story. In fact, I recommend a book by Burton Folsom called The Myth of the Rubber Bands. It's a very thin book. You can read it one sitting, a couple of hours or less. It tells the story of, I think, six captains of industry of the United States in the United States in like late 19th, early 20th century, including John D. Rockefeller, J.J. Hill. I think Vanderbilt is in there, the Scrantons are in there, Mellon. It's a very, very interesting book. It actually dispels a lot of very bad myths about the American industry and the so-called robber barons, which were not robber barons at all. And again, that book is deserving of a completely separate video, but I'm not going to go into that anymore. I just recommend that you pick it up. Again, if you don't want to buy it, if you're in a greater New York City area, I can just lend it to you. I can lend you my copy and read it. So, yeah, the story of James J. Hill is in there. I highly recommend it. So, to sum it up, there are examples of the so-called private goods, public goods being successfully produced privately. There's a big problem with the argument that just because you declare some good a public good that the government needs to produce it. That's completely not self-evident at all, to say the least. And the non-rivalrousness and non-excludability are actually questionable if you start looking at real-life examples. And that pretty much sums up my case. I think public goods may not even exist. If they do exist, and you can bring up the prisoner's dilemma and whatnot, okay, fine, but give me an example of a real economic good, real life economic good, that resulted in some kind of bad situation for consumers because some public good was not able to be publicly, privately produced, either at all or in sufficient amounts. I guess that's it.